Chapter 40. Jingzha and Muja escaped riding dust clouds, and Nezha raced away on his wind fire wheels. Dragon Beard Tiger fled through water. Back in the city, Jiang Ziya counted the losses and found that most of his generals were wounded and 9 had been killed. 6 of them were princes, sons of Prince Wen. He was stricken with grief. At the same time, the Shang army returned to their camp dancing and singing. The 4 generals immediately held a military conference. "Surround the city and attack with all our strength until we get hold of Jiang Ziya and King Wu," Mo Lihong said optimistically. "You're absolutely right, brother," Mo Liqing said. The following day, they surrounded West Yi City. Jiang Ziya dared not encounter them again. He ordered that the boards of truce be hung on the watchtowers and refused to answer any challenge. But Mo Liqing disregarded the boards. "Put up scaling ladders all round the city walls and use the cannons," he ordered. The situation in the city became critical. Jiang Ziya put up a strong resistance. He mounted the wall with Jingzha, Muja, Nezha, Huangfeihu, Dragon Beard Tiger, and the other unwounded generals. They defended the city with lime bottles, stone balls, burning arrows, and long spears day and night. After 3 days, the Sheng army had suffered heavy losses, but had still failed to break through the city defense. "Withdraw the army," Mo Lihong ordered. That night, the 4 brothers discussed the situation again. "As a disciple on Mount Kunlun, Jiang Sheng's well-trained in war tactics. We can't take the city by force, so we'd better besiege them until they run out of supplies. We'll prevent them from getting any reinforcements from outside, and the city will fall of its own accord," Mo Lihong suggested. "You're right, brother," said Mo Liqing. But after 2 months, and the besieged city was still holding out, they became worried. "It's been nearly 3 months, but we still haven't captured the city. What shall we do? We've got 100,000 soldiers, and our expenses are high. We'd be ashamed if Grand Tutor Wen should reprimand us. How about this, we all send our magic weapons into the air tonight and destroy West Qi City in one blow. It seems the only sensible way to go now," Mo Liqing proposed. "Excellent idea. Let's take action tonight, brother," Mo Lixiu agreed. Jiang Ziya was discussing with Huangfeihu and the other generals about how to repulse the Sheng army when a sudden wind whipped through the hall, snapping the pole of a big banner in two. This strange phenomenon alarmed him. He quickly burned incense and made a divination with gold coins. He read the results, and his face turned pale with fright. He immediately bathed, changed his robes, burned more incense, and kowtowed toward Mount Kunlun. Hair loosened and sword in hand, he moved the whole North Sea over to cover West Qi City. At the very same time, the Mo brothers' plan had also been discovered by Heavenly Primogenitor. He sprinkled a few drops of divine water of the three lights from his glazed vase over West Qi City, where it floated on the surface of the sea. Early that night, Mo Liqing waved his green cloud sword, Mo Lihong twirled his umbrella, Mo Lihai plucked the strings of his lute, and Mo Lixiu released his ermine. Dark clouds rapidly covered the sky, and a cold fog enveloped the earth. Thunderclaps rang out as if heaven itself was about to collapse. The 4 brothers played their magic weapons, expecting to achieve great success, and return to the capital in triumph the next day. They did not return satisfied to their camp until dawn. Jiang Ziya sent the water back to the sea at sunrise, and the city reappeared as usual. The Sheng soldiers rushed to the camp and reported the news to the 4 brothers. They were astonished and went to see for themselves. Sure enough, they found the report to be true. They were at a loss what to do next and had no choice but to continue the siege of the city. Though he had saved the city from disaster that once, Jiang Ziya could not put down his defenses. Time passed swiftly and another 2 months elapsed. He still had no way of repulsing the 4 generals. Then one day the officer in charge of the grain stores reported, "We're running short of food. Our supplies will only last about 10 more days. What shall we do? This is more serious than if they attacked us. Jiang Ziya murmured, greatly worried. Prime Minister, you may demand that the rich open their private granaries and each lend us 50,000 pecks of grain. We'll return it with interest when we've defeated the enemy. That's the only solution now. Huang Feihu suggested. That will never do, General. It would create panic among the people and army. Let's consider it more carefully. We still have 10 days. 8 days passed. Jiang Ziya was extremely worried. But then a guard reported. Two young Taoist lads request to see you. When they were ushered in, they bowed and greeted Jiang Ziya. How do you do, uncle? Where do you come from? What instructions do you have for me? Jiang Ziya asked as he returned their salutations. We are disciples of the heavenly master of divine virtue. My name's Han Dulong, the poisonous dragon, and he's named Xu Ohu, the wicked tiger. By order of our master, we've come here to offer you food supplies. Where are they? We're carrying them on us. But I'll show you a short letter from our master first. Han Dulong said. He took the letter from a silk purse and handed it to Jiang Ziya, who read it carefully. My master told me that highly talented men would come to my aid in time of crisis, and your arrival today has proven his word. Jiang Ziya said, delighted. When he asked them for the promised food supply, one of them took a container from his leopard skin bag. It was full of rice, but could contain no more than a peck at most. The generals held back their laughter with difficulty. But Jiang Ziya asked Han Dulong to take the rice to the city's three granaries. About 3 hours later, the officer in charge came in. All the barns are now overflowing with rice. At this, Jiang Ziya said happily, "A blessing from heaven on King Wu." They now had sufficient food to maintain resistance, but were still unable to beat the Mo generals. Jiang Ziya strengthened the city defenses but dared not take any other action. Another 2 months passed. As nearly a whole year had gone by, and they had still failed to take the city, the four brothers wrote a report to Grand Tutor Wen, saying that Jiang Ziya was not only good at offense, but also skillful at defense, and that was why they had not won even after so many months. One day, Jiang Ziya was talking with his generals when a guard came in. A Taoist at the gate wishes to see you. When the visitor was ushered in, those present saw that he wore a cloud fanning hat, a robe with a silk belt, and a pair of hemp shoes. He bowed at the door and offered his greetings, addressing Jiang as, "Uncle, where do you come from?" "I'm a disciple of Jade Tripod. By order of my master, I've come to place myself at your service. My name's Yang Jian." Jiang Ziya was very pleased. He introduced Yang Jian to his generals and then took him to meet King Wu. On their return, Yang Jian asked, "Who are the generals besieging the city?" Jiang Ziya told him, "Since I'm here, you can remove the board of truce. I'd like to meet them and try them out. If I don't do battle with them, how can I find out how to cope with them?" Jiang Ziya agreed and ordered his men to remove the board of truce from the city wall. A scout immediately reported to the Mo brothers that West Ji's just removed their board of truce from the city wall. They were delighted and left their camp straightway to give a challenge. Jiang Ziya ordered Yang Jian to meet the challenge with Nijia. The Mo brothers saw a general emerge from the city. He wore a cloud fanning hat and a robe with a silk belt, rode a white horse, and carried a long lance. It was difficult to tell whether he was a Taoist or a layman. "Who are you?" Mo Liqing asked. "T.M. Yang Jian, nephew of Prime Minister Jiang. How dare you come here hounding the people with your witchcraft? I'll teach you a lesson, and you'll die without a place to bury your corpses." He galloped forward and stabbed at them with his lance. The brothers had had no chance to fight for half a year and ran out on foot to engage him. They surrounded him and fought fiercely under the city wall. As they battled, General Ma Qinlong arrived with food supplies from Chuzhou. he found that his path was blocked and spurred his chestnut horse forward. "Here I come," he cried. Whirling his twin cutlasses, he fought into the circle against the Mo generals. When he saw that another Zhou general had joined the battle, Mo Lisho hurriedly released his ermine into the air. It transformed into a huge white elephant and, swooping down, swallowed half of General Ma Qinglong in a single gulp. Seeing this, Yang Jian was secretly delighted. "So that's the devil and the cause of all the trouble. I'll deal with him." The Mo generals did not know that Yang Jian had great magic powers. When the spotted ermine flew up into the air again, it swallowed half of Yang Jian. Neja saw it all and retreated into the city, rushing to the prime minister's mansion. "Yang Jian's been devoured by the spotted ermine," he told Jiang Ziya, who became extremely worried. Returning in triumph, the Mo brothers drank together joyfully. Early that night, Mo Lisho suggested, "Brothers, I'll send the ermine into the city tonight to devour Jiang Ziya and King Wu. Once that's done, we can return home victoriously, and we won't need to waste our time continuing the siege." As the four generals were already drunk, they all talked wildly. "You're right, brother. Do it at once." Mo Liqing agreed readily. Mo Lisho took the ermine from his bag. "Darling, you can do no greater service than to eat both Jiang Ziya and King Wu." Released into the sky, the ermine flew off and disappeared. But the ermine was a wild animal. How could it realize that by swallowing Yang Jian, it had brought disaster on itself? Yang Jian had great magic powers.